my pleasure to welcome again our next speaker, Prof. Hany Ali. Prof. Ali is the Director of Division of Newborn Services and Professor of Pediatric and Obstetric at George Washington University. Prof. Ali, he will speak about high-flow nasal cannula for respiratory support for preterm infants. Welcome, Prof. Ali.
Assalamu alaikum. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So in the next 20 minutes, I will discuss the use of high-flow nasal cannula for respiratory support of preterm infants. So in fact, I will go over recent trials and reviews, and then for a few minutes, and then we'll go after that to put our reflection on how to use these trials in clinical practice. So this is the most recent trial published in New England Journal of Medicine, September 2016, discussing high-flow nasal cannula for primary respiratory support in premature infants. So the multi-center trial comparing nasal high-flow therapy with CPAP as primary support for premature infants with respiratory distress, and it showed higher treatment failure rate with high-flow therapy. And the treatment failure rate was defined as the need of oxygen of 40% or more. So high-flow nasal cannula, babies require higher oxygen compared to babies on CPAP. The inclusion criteria, babies between 28 weeks and 37 weeks, an average birth weight was around 1,750 grams, and almost 50% of this population were less than 32 weeks, and the other 50% higher than 32 weeks of gestation. So the baseline characteristics of the study population, high-flow nasal cannula versus CPAP, you can see they are very similar on all aspects. So the average gestational age was 32 weeks plus minus 2 versus 32 plus minus 2.2. Very close. And the birth weight in the high-flow nasal cannula, 1,737, and in the CPAP, 1,751. The primary outcome, which is need for oxygen, 40% or more, or and intubation within the first 72 hours of life. And you can see the ones on a high-flow nasal cannula, they have a significantly increased percent of babies who are requiring 40% oxygen or more. In the high-flow nasal cannula, one quarter of the babies were on 40% or more, 25.5%, while in the CPAP, 13.3%. So the reason for treatment failure and other secondary outcomes, I would like you to go under, I just underlined two of them, urgent need for intubation, and the very last one, any received oxygen. So in the high-flow nasal cannula, 78% of babies were on oxygen. In CPAP group, only 70%, and that was also significant. Adverse events, postnatal steroids, nasal trauma, of course, with CPAP, there were more nasal trauma, significantly more nasal trauma. Just a quick question, is nasal trauma due to the CPAP or due to the care providing while giving CPAP? Okay. How about bed sores for old people on long, prolonged hospitalization? When they have bed sores, is it a problem from the bed or from the care providing for the patient on the bed? I mean, we don't have bed sores at home. but you have it. So it is really the care. So I personally utilize the nasal trauma as an index of how professional the group who are doing the trial for the familiarity with CPAP. The more of trauma to the nose, it indicates how much unfamiliar the group who are providing the CPAP. So the conclusion from this trial, when used as primary support for preterm infants with respiratory distress, high flow therapy resulted in a significantly higher rate of treatment failure than did CPAP. I would like to visit another trial that was published in 2015. This study came here from the Middle East, from Haifa. Only 76 patients, 38 in each group, and they didn't find significant difference in the need for intubation, ventilation, 29% versus 34% for both groups. And here, when you don't see a difference, we just ask the failure to prove a difference. Lots of time it is low because of the power of the study. You cannot prove a difference when you have a lower number of population. 38 babies in each group may not be the appropriate size, so the study was not powered to show. But the problem is you use this study in another meta-analysis to show that nasal cannula had similar intubation rate to CPAP. This one of the largest randomized control trial published 2013, comparing high flow nasal cannula to CPAP, 28 weeks to 42 weeks the population. There was no difference in intubation rate. 15% of babies were intubated on nasal cannula versus 11% for babies on CPAP. And this is another issue here. It's a little philosophical discussion. How often do you have babies who are 28 to 42 weeks who have BPD? So the study here in the CPAP group, 16% of them has BPD. But we are trained when we are doing studies or when reading studies to look to how the structure of the study was. Was it randomized? Was there a control group? We look to the method and we don't look to the outcomes. So when you have a group of babies greater than 28 weeks, 16% of them has BPD, 18% of them went home on oxygen. We don't question the quality of care provided or the training and familiarity with the use of CPAP. But we take the outcome, there was no difference for high flow nasal cannula and CPAP. And let me give you one of the examples. If I would like to ask, does using gloves will interfere with your skill in putting IV or not? So randomized controlled trial, half of the group you put gloves on when you are putting the IV, and the other half you don't put gloves on when you put the IV. And here are the results, and let's see what is the conclusion. In the group that has the gloves on, your success rate with IV insertion was 0%. And the group without gloves on, success rate was 0%. So the conclusion, there is no difference. Putting on gloves will not interfere with the outcomes. But nobody would ask, when you have 200 people putting IV and failed all, how can I use this group of people to conclude, extrapolate to the entire population? Here is a group 28 weeks to 42 weeks of gestation having 16% BPD, 18% going home on oxygen, but it was randomized controlled trial. So there is no difference. Then you extrapolate and take that and use the nasal cannula in your own unit to say it is no different than CPAP, which is not correct. The Cochrane review, basically they did what I just mentioned to you, looking to the study, and they found it's equally effective, CPAP versus, or in IPPV or CPAP versus nasal cannula, and especially for post-extubation babies. And here I would like to also mention one other thing. One of the major rules, even culturally, why we have prophets, you need to have a living example to follow. So you are practicing based on a living example. There is a prophet that you followed. So always look for a living example or even historical example. So for example, if I'm using high flow nasal cannula and I have 40% instance of BPD, and then you are following that, would you ever expect your BPD will be 5%? So answer, it will never be. And here's my question. When you review literature, did you ever see a single center worldwide who is using nasal cannula and have a single digit BPD, like 5%, 6%, 9%? The answer is no. There is not a single study showing that using nasal cannula could bring BPD down to 9% or 8% or 7%. However, when you look to the study, the only centers that have BPD lower than 10%, these are the centers who never used CPAP. Who never used nasal cannula. And that is the dilemma. You have centers using, having very low BPD, and they claim we have never used nasal cannula. And then group who are doing randomized control trial, they only showed that nasal cannula is working by having bad CPAP results in their units. This is one study, randomized control trial, that I was contributing in it. When you have babies on 30% of oxygen or less, randomly assign them either to nasal cannula or continuous CPAP. And the study showed that when you wean off CPAP down to nasal cannula, you have prolonged use of oxygen and you have prolonged use of respiratory support. So I just would like to mention to you, this is animal study that showed the yellow bars are animals who are on CPAP, and the red bars are animals who are not in CPAP. And you can see it takes around 2 weeks for the lung volume, this is the total lung capacity, to significantly increase. So there is a chronic use of CPAP or long use of CPAP stimulate the lung to grow and make the lung bigger, and that's how we cut on BPD. It's not only the lung volume, but the lung weight, the protein content, the DNA, they are all significantly increased after 2 weeks. So when you have a baby who needs less oxygen and you take him off CPAP prematurely, you ended up by preventing the lung from growing based on this study. Just a reminder about the COIN trial, when compared CPAP versus ventilation and could not see a decreased instance of BPD when using CPAP, because the days on CPAP in the CPAP group was only 13 days, but days on oxygen were 42 days. So these units typically use CPAP for 2 weeks, followed by nasal cannula for another 4 weeks. Then BPD did not decrease. Here is the comparison between 8 centers in the United States and Canada, and you can see the instance, the lower segment of the bar, instance of BPD, center number 3, which is 4%, was Columbia University, having used CPAP, never used nasal cannula. Nobody looked for the variation between centers. When you have a BPD of 4 versus 40%, you would wonder, should we first try to bring everybody down to 4% using that strategy? Then you start to do a randomized control trial rather than you insist on having the no use of CPAP and you start to randomly assign babies when you already have a high BPD. Does parachute prevent this? So the scientific answer is no. There is no randomized control trial to show that using parachute will prevent this. It's all observational study. And this published in the British Medical Journal in 2008. But do you really throw yourself without a parachute? You never do that. But you will do to babies that you are taking care of in the NICU, because there is no evidence. Then let me switch. So in fact, in our own daily activity, we don't necessarily use the exact evidence-based medicine. We use also the experience and the common sense. So the absence of evidence, and this was one of my commentary in Pediatrics 2007, when you say there is no evidence to say one thing is better than the other, it is not evidence by itself of absence. Absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. When you are looking to any randomized controlled trial or any study, there is a process. Was it randomized or not? Placebo control or not? That's a process. But there is a content, and the content should make common sense. If the content doesn't make common sense, then the process may not be. And that's exactly what I mentioned about using gloves for IVs or bed sores and multiple other stuff. Should be making a common sense. So Dr. Kaptan, he said, in order to get your CME, this is a hypothetical example. You will not get your CME unless you sign when you enter in the room. That's the only evidence that Dr. Kaptan considered that you attended. He made the rule. But then an elephant entered the room. And of course the elephant didn't sign. Does it mean the elephant is not in the room? Or mean we don't have evidence that the elephant is in the room? So instead of us going back to revise the rule, or what does it mean, evidence? We tend to even don't believe the facts. So at Columbia University, at George Washington University, when I see any randomized controlled trial, I don't even read the paper before going to one number. Down, look to the results. What is the PPD rate? My PPD rate is 5%. If the study showed a PPD rate of 5, 6, 10, I will read the study. But the study showing PPD of 40%, how this study will help my outcomes? So really, that's a missing point in evidence-based medicine. We don't look at it, though it is the most important piece before doing any study. Does the use of surfactant decrease the failure rate with CPAP, extubation, failure rate? Here is one study, randomized, just make sure, it's a randomized controlled trial. So when you have a baby's 29 weeks to 36 weeks, they extubate them to CPAP, 60% of them fail CPAP. But when they give surfactant, 50% fail CPAP. How often you have a 36-weeker who fail extubation and have to be reintubated without surfactant? But the study is randomized controlled trial. Then you take out from that surfactant improve the use of CPAP. How about the center who has 5% BBD and don't use routine surfactant? But the randomized controlled trial is saying surfactant is good. Here is the failure rate, as I published in Pediatrics. When you go to baby who is 32 weeks, the x-axis is the gestational age. 0 to 2 or 3% failure rate. While here, 60%. So really, we just need to connect these dots. Study randomized controlled trial, published in Pediatrics by Rojas et al. 2009. Use of surfactant and BPD for the success of CPAP. Instance of BPD on babies less than 1500 gram in this trial, 59%. Use 59% BPD rate, but if they in the surfactant group, it came down to 49%. So the bottom line is that the conclusion, based on this randomized controlled trial, giving surfactant decreased BPD or improves the experience with CPAP.
So really we need to connect these dots between what is the outcome and then the process. Is it randomized or not randomized? That will be a secondary point. I just would like to finalize my discussion when this is my own experience published in Pediatrics 2005. The red line represents my BPD rate, and the blue line is the use of CPAP rate. So in fact, when I started the use, I started at the unit, has a BPD rate 33%. I started to use CPAP, but I was convinced with my colleagues, how about the babies already stabilized with CPAP? Why don't you take him off CPAP, put him on nasal cannula once he's stabilized to make it easy on the nurses and on the baby? And I agreed. And then you can see this up net coming up there, and BBD actually increased to 40% in the first year of applying CPAP. Then when I start to see it getting worse, I came back to do exactly what Colombia has been using. No more nasal cannula, just CPAP only. Then BBD came down to 6% in 2005 and just reported last month 5% BBD, use of oxygen 36 weeks in babies less than 1500 grams. So my conclusions, there is not a single study that demonstrated a single digit instance of BBD while using high flow nasal cannula. Please, if you find one, help me by sending that article or reference to me. Find any article in PubMed that showed babies on nasal cannula had BBD of 9 or 8 or 7 or 6%. NICUs with the lowest instance of BBD, they actually do not use high flow nasal cannula. They use CPAP. I would like to actually give you a personal experience, because I keep giving this type of lectures, and I don't see a single digit BBD without bubble CPAP. And then one time I looked to Cochrane review, and then I found one of the studies showed reported BBD of 9%. And that was from a person that I don't know. So I went back, I searched, then I found it was a unit from Chile. And the unit from Chile, they came and visited GW 15 years ago, and they have us to visit them, and now they published. So even the new center that has 9% ended up being a bubble CPAP unit. Strategies that improve outcomes should be favored over those that offer easier care. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Prof. Ali, for your interesting, debating lectures.